Hey, this is BJ. Thanks for listening to our show's podcast. If you're a fan of all things geeky, you should check out my other podcast, BJ Shea's Geek Nation. We have new episodes every day, and you can check it out at bjgeeknation.com.
Your driver's license is important so you can get back and forth to work, get your kids to school, and back and forth to daycare. If your license has been suspended because you can't pay your tickets, you can't do any of those things. Let's talk about Chapter 13 bankruptcy. You may have heard that tickets cannot be discharged, but they can be dealt with in a Chapter 13 case. Why not come in for a free consultation? The chapter you choose will make all the difference to your getting back, legally, on the road. Let's design a plan to pay off your tickets and restore your license immediately. I'm Attorney Travis Gagne. Please contact me today at ChooseTheRightChapter.com. That's ChooseTheRightChapter.com.
99.9 KISW, The Rock of Seattle. There's a tweet that's going viral right now from Business Insider's food website. And it's called Food Insider, as a matter of fact. And they're saying that we, the people, have been eating burgers wrong our whole lives.
How are you, a fork and knife, are we supposed to eat it with?
No. See, you got the hands. The hands are the right thing. They're saying...
Oh, of course you need hands to eat. I'm not going to eat like a horse.
Well, without the fork and knife.
Face in a trough.
Well, I don't know. You'd look good doing it.
I feel like you've done that before.
Yeah.
Recently.
Maybe not when I'm not sober.
Yeah. But
yes.
They're saying we're supposed to eat the burgers upside down. Like we normally eat them the way they're given to us. And they're saying, no, you should eat burgers upside down. The reason being, in their theory, is that the top bun is bigger than the bottom bun, so it'll do a better job absorbing all the juices and condiments and keeping everything together so your burger won't be as likely to fall apart or drip as you eat it.
Have you ever accidentally had a burger or a sandwich upside down? It does taste different.
It does not.
It does. Certain parts are hitting your, taste buds before that you anticipate them to.
Good point.
No different than like if I have a chocolate bar, like I have those RX bars I really like, and my favorite one, it has a sea salt and either chocolate or caramel or whatever. And the side that has the sea salt on it tastes completely different than the side. So if I eat it one way, I get a different taste sensation than if I eat it the other way.
I'll have to try that. I mean, I think it makes sense what you're saying.
Because your tongue is only on one side, man.
I mean, it's a good excuse to go get a hamburger today. So
two hamburgers.
Oh, yeah, two hamburgers. I got to try that for science.
Yeah, I got to try it for science.
Just like when you eat like a peanut butter and jelly sandwich or anything, it has to be diagonal. It tastes better diagonal for something.
Okay, well, that's silly.
No, you're silly.
No.
You shut up.
Yeah, I don't know how the diagonal affects it.
Like, I mean, it feels better to eat it that way because you aren't getting all the schmutz on your face.
Oh, well, that's different than taste.
But it does feel like the better eating experience, so it tastes better.
I your crust cut off, too, huh?
Yeah.
I'll eat an Uncrustable, the little frozen ones.
We have real scientists that actually, instead of
with the crazy Twitter page Food Insider.
Yeah, these guys are talking about the whole thing.
I recently heard that the correct way to eat a burger is to hold it upside down. The reason for this is that the bun is usually thicker on top, so by flipping it, there's more bread underneath to absorb the juices, and the burger is less likely to disintegrate. With this in mind, I'm going to order two burgers and put it to the test.
Juicy!
Does seem to be staying together better, this one. The one I ate the normal way up was a lot messier than the other one, but the main difference was a lot more of the juices just spilled right out, whereas the upside-down one really held itself together better.
Well, how about that? Well, there you go then.
I mean, I'm watching the video and she has a side-by-side comparison of how when she eats it upside down and when she eats it regular. And the regular way, the juices were spilling out more. This seems ridiculous.
I want to see if it tastes different, though, Steve. I think you make a good point because obviously your tongue is at the bottom of your mouth. And if you flip something the other way, I want to try it with like a lot of things now.
Mm-hmm. I've heard that the other proper way to hold a burger is that you have to put your pinkies underneath the burger when you hold it. So it gives you better stability. The stuff doesn't fall out.
Here's my question. Do you put the condiments on the top bun or the bottom bun?
Top.
Typically on the top. But sometimes if there's like just too much crap on top, I'll just put it on the bottom.
Does it taste different?
Yes.
See, yeah, okay.
It makes sense. It makes sense that if your taste buds are on your tongue and your tongue's on the bottom, that whatever that surface that hits the tongue first, that's what you're going to taste first.
So do we need to eat hot dogs upside down? That could get messy.
Oh, yeah, you're right. Well, I think that should be okay.
Someone wants to know if we're still talking about food, right?
Yeah, we are.
This is food that we're talking about that's dripping out of your mouth.
Yeah, there is that. I will say I like that girl in that video. I'd like to go. I'd go to lunch with her.
But why the hell do we need that weird music being played?
Well, apparently we're a generation that we can't have silence. I think that's really what the problem is.
So he says, I like my peanut butter on the top.
On the top. Well, isn't that where everybody puts it in the top?
Peanut butter and jelly.
Yeah. I mean, I always put the peanut butter on top.
I always did peanut butter first and then.
Oh, I do one. No, I do the one on one bread, one on the other bread. Yeah, I don't do them both on the same piece of bread.
See, like my grilled cheese, I like on top.
The cheese or the peanut butter?
It's just cheese.
It's scintillating.
Cheese on both sides. It really doesn't matter.
Actually, have you ever put cheese on top of the sandwich?
A peanut butter and jelly?
No, grilled cheese.
Well, we're talking about peanut butter and jelly,
I
thought.
And then he started talking about cheese. So
I know, you're not supposed to follow everything he says.
I just say stupid things for the sake of saying stupid things. Don't follow me on that.
Yeah, well, I'm stupid, so I'm going to follow the stupid train.
Did you take your attention?
I did not. I forgot
your medicine,
today.
Did you? No,
I didn't, take it today.
Because everything you say, Vic's going to go, oh, I like turtles.
No, but seriously, cheese on top of a grilled cheese sandwich is the best.
Well, cheese on top of anything is really pretty amazing.
It gives it a nice crust.
Even that stupid Pat's steak in Philadelphia, throw cheese whiz on it, it makes it bearable.
Wait, so you then, as soon as you have your grilled cheese done, you're grabbing like a slice of cheese and putting it on top and not cooking it? Or
you do more like a shredded cheese. You put it on the pan so it melts first, then you put the bread on top of it, and then you put your regular cheese inside, and then you kind of flip it over and add more cheese to the pan. It gives it a nice crust. It's added cheese, and you can even do a different type of cheese for added flavor.
Somebody says they like frosted flakes with their grilled cheese. That seems ridiculous.
Wait, inside the, or?
I'm guessing.
Weird.
Well, I know that when, we're totally off tangent, but.
Somebody says you're supposed to eat hot dogs on your knees. I didn't know that.
Oh, that's right. Yeah.
Looking up.
Yeah, that's what you got to do. Hey, I got a new hero here we got to talk about.
Who's your new hero?
This kid's going to be a politician when he grows up. He's 9 years old. His name is Dane. He lives in Colorado. Dane went to his city council on Monday. This 9-year-old went to the city council because he loves snowball fights and they're illegal where he lives.
Random.
I there are always some laws that are weird in certain places.
True.
And this is one of them. And so he went to city council on Monday and he gave this awesome speech, which they, you know, said, look, you got to turn this over, man. 98 years we've had this stupid law. I want snowball fights legal within city limits. And first he started talking to his mom. He's like, Mom, we got to get this done.
It's an outdated law, and I want to throw a snowball without getting in trouble.
He came home, and he was really engaged with, Mom, these laws are silly.
I asked my mom if I could do it, and she called the town hall, and then she told me I had to make a speech.
And that's exactly what he did. He went to city hall.
This kid's cute. He's got a little bow tie on. He got dressed up for the whole thing.
Yeah, same with a snowball in his hand.
I'm looking at it, like, it looks like the law is more about throwing stones or missiles, but maybe they just incorporated snowballs into it because
anything that's a projectile.
They say it's unlawful for any person to throw or shoot any stone or any other missile upon or at any person, animal, building, tree, or other public or private property.
Yeah.
He got 20 letters from kids in his class as well when he came to do this argument.
And here's a clip from his speech as he's in front of city council.
Today's kids need reason to play outside. Research suggests that a lack of exposure to the outdoors can lead to obesity, ADHD, anxiety, and depression. Kids want to have snowball fights without breaking the law.
Sounds like you just changed the law, buddy.
How about that? There's nothing like the adorability factor. That gets stuff done.
Yeah.
And he cited stuff, you know, which is what he used the buzz, the buzz phrases, the buzzwords about the obesity. Kids need to get outside. Yeah, I love this kid.
Never been more proud to be an American, BJ.
Yeah, he got it done.
That's hilarious.
Yeah, I mean, when kids are that young, the snowball fights shouldn't be a problem because they're, for the most part, padded. They shouldn't be getting hurt by them.
Okay, here's the question. When it came to snowball fights, you were either just a person that enjoyed snowball fights or a giant D-bag. Were you the type of person that tried to incorporate a piece of ice in your snowball?
No, okay. I didn't. Only if there was somebody that was just a jerk, and I was like, okay, buddy, you know what? Because I was never very physical and athletic, therefore I was always getting wrecked.
We had the one kid in our neighborhood, Douglas LaLima. He's dead now.
You know what? He's dead, don't you?
Well, no, he died. He got electrocuted for his job. He was like a telephone person, and I saw that in the news. I was like, oh my gosh.
Touching tribute.
He was the biggest bully in our neighborhood, though, man. He would be that kid.
Like, he would throw the ice in there?
He would pack the snowball with a chunk of ice, like an icicle or something, and then throw it, and it would hit you, and I used to get so pissed at him because he would always get me with it, so I finally was like, screw this, and I got a snowball, I packed it, and I put it in my freezer at my house, and I froze it. I'm like, you want to do this? I'm coming at you with a real
look at
like
you.
A, a, a full-on ice ball. And when we had a snowball fight, because that was inevitable, that happened, I ran into my house. I got that one. I was like, I'm going to get Douglas Salima. He's going to get it. I chucked it at him, and he ducked, and I broke my dad's window on his car.
Whoops.
Oh, yeah.
Douglas won because I got a whooping for that.
That is so awesome.
You should have blamed it on him.
My fault.
Oh, that is the best. That had to be a hell of an ice ball if you're breaking a car window with it.
Oh, dude, this thing was solid. Whoa. It was a rock.
You would have killed the kid.
Yeah, looking back on it, it was a bad idea.
Yeah.
I'm just surprised you didn't, you know, make it yellow snow first.
Where were you when I was growing up?
Right? We would have taken over that block.
That would have been, See, now that would have been awesome if you just brought a little yellow, you know, container of yellow.
Even snow pea ball.
Yeah. And go, okay, buddy, here it comes.
That person brought up a good point. What jerk of a cop would actually give a citation to a kid for having a snowball fight?
Well, you know, or, you know, what if, it's very,
you gotta,
very.
You got to let that one slide.
Dude, there.
Yeah, you got to, right?
There are people out there who will shut down kids' lemonade stands for not having permits.
Yeah,
so,
yeah,
I mean,
right.
There's all sorts of people who want to use their power.
That's just un-American. All of that is un-American.
We'd get suspended in elementary school if we did snowball fights.
Oh, really?
Yeah. What? Yeah, at recess and stuff, because it was the same reason. They didn't want us getting hurt and then the school being in trouble and blah, blah, blah. So if you had any kind of snowball fight, you would get sent home.
I grew up in a really great time. I think you guys got screwed. I'm just going to tell you that right now. I think you guys, man, is helicopter parenting. I don't think you'll ever get to have fun the way I did.
Yeah.
And I mean, look, I'm still alive, and I was a weak kid. I wasn't like, if anybody needed protecting, it was me, because I couldn't keep up with a lot of folks. And yet I'm still alive.
Yeah, how do you shut that down? That's like the best part of whenever it would snow in New York. I remember sometimes we'd get like 4 feet of snow.
Whoa.
And it was just that moment when you realize I could go outside. A, school's canceled. That's awesome.
Yeah.
And B, I could go outside and we could just build a fort and then have snowball wars.
Yeah.
Yeah, Vicky gave us a wool because, of course, she's a Washingtonian, or I should say a Western Washingtonian. You don't get to see that here, Seattle proper.
No, I'm just thinking that's, you know, I'm not going to be able to see. It's going to hit me in the eyes.
Oh,
like,
dude.
I wouldn't be able to walk through that snow.
If you grew up in the Northeast, you know, if you're in the Buffalo, Rochester, Boston, that kind of area, you would have been like, you'd be done. No one would ever see you.
I need to get stilts or something because I'd just be stuck in the snow.
You need like snowshoes every time. Yeah.
Oh, if you were my kid, I would have definitely bought you everything white and just let you go outside. People, where'd Vicky go? And nobody would ever see you.
Did you ever try and take advantage of the, not take advantage, it was a business opportunity, but go and shovel all the snow, or snovel, the two words.
Yeah.
Shovel all the snow in the neighborhood to get money from the neighbors?
You know what, dude? This is how bad I was. I would be like, no, it's not worth it.
Oh, I'd spend
hard
all day.
It was hard work.
It was ridiculous, man.
Yeah, really hard work.
Especially when you had like 3-4 feet of snow, and I would be out there all day just to get $10 from each neighbor.
Oh, yeah, you're a better man than me. I would instead spend that 3 or 4 hours bugging my father.
Yeah.
To give me money. Yeah. You know, rather than go out and actually do any physical work.
Plus, then you could kind of create your own mountains. My dad liked it because then I would have to, he would make me shovel the snow into an empty parking spot outside of our house so that nobody would park in front of our house.
Oh.
It would just be this giant mountain, which was fun for us kids because we'd climb it and slide down.
Your father's awesome.
Oh, dude.
Yeah.
He got to the point where he hated having someone park in front of that spot that he bought a car, a junker, and parked it there so nobody else can park in front of the house.
Oh, man, that's so bizarre. Why did that bother him so much?
Because sometimes people wouldn't park very well and their car would maybe be a foot into the driveway.
Oh,
and that
sucks.
Just made him. I mean, he sometimes would just stand in the front of our house watching people park and yell at them during the Christmas season because, you know, people were always coming and going. And we lived a block from the mall. And he's like, "You're parked wrong." And they're just like, "Huh? I'm just parked."
Oh, man.
"You got a foot in my driveway. Back up."
Your dad's the man.
So eventually he just finally had it and he bought a junker.
That's actually a pretty good idea.
Yeah, I mean, it was not a bad car, but it wasn't like something that he ever used. He just parked it there for the sake. He paid the insurance and everything.
Wow.
Just to guarantee nobody would park in front of our house.
That's that's city living right there.
It's a man who lost it.
City peace of mind falling down right there. Got this guy in Pennsylvania. He just got his wallet back. Hey, Danny, see that? You got a wallet for your birthday? This guy got his wallet back.
Yeah.
He lost it.
We're the same guy.
Yeah, you're the same guy. Four years ago, he lost his wallet. And it was on a roller coaster, Steve. I hope you secure your valuables when you're on a roller coaster.
That's always my fear. Thankfully, now they have, like, you can just go in and rent a locker. But just like you scan your ticket and then you can keep it some in that locker for an hour for free, which is nice. It's very rare that an amusement park they're not trying to gouge you for money.
That is nice.
And I just got into a habit of anytime we're doing a roller coaster, I would go upside down, just chuck everything in there. Because I would always be like, what if my wallet wouldn't bug me as much as if I lost my cell phone? Like, that would really bother me.
That would be a problem.
You need a wallet chain.
Yeah, it's not 1997 anymore.
But I'm just saying, you look cool and you get to keep your wallet.
I know, Danny. When is Danny going to realize and look in the mirror that he's like a couple decades like off?
He's still in a pop punk look from 1997.
Yeah, it's hysterical. Yeah.
It's really pretty awesome.
And you're how old are you now, Danny, today?
32.
When will it? I'm telling you, at 35, I think that's when you have to start making decisions about if what you're wearing is way out of date. Not so much could you dress. You know what I mean?
Who's to say, though? People probably poo-pooed people wearing bell bottoms again and then became fashionable for a minute.
Well, that's every fashion. But I mean, until it comes back, I mean, I could wear, you know.
He could be the trendsetter.
Exactly.
I'm bringing it back. Steve?
Probably not, but if he's happy with wearing a wallet chain and he's okay with us making fun of him for it, then what's the big deal?
Oh, yeah, I'm good with it.
All right, cool.
Yeah,
you continue to wear it.
That's okay. The most important part. If you're not okay with us making fun of it, then you have to stop wearing the wallet chain.
Fair enough.
That's how it's going to go. Yeah. Well, this guy found his wallet. He got it back 4 years. How about 4 years later, you're like, oh, what? And here he is with his family talking about how amazed they were when they got a call from the park.
At the end, I'm walking down the steps, and I just happen to pat my side here, and no wallet. It was gone. So when I got the call that somebody actually found it, I just laughed out loud.
It looked disgusting because there's mold in it. And the leather was all dusty.
Yeah.
And all the credit cards were all like moldy and green.
It has become our running family joke. We don't go to Hershey Park and don't mention the missing wallet.
Now I'm really pretty disappointed because now we can't do the funny story where they say, kids, look for my wallet in the bushes and that stuff.
That's a funny story. Okay. Alrighty. Why did they put that in the story? Because it was a cute kid. That made no sense to me whatsoever.
You never did the old, kids, put my wallet in the bushes.
Come on, news people. You should have asked the parent. What the hell is your stupid kid talking about? That's the first thing you should have said. Is your kid high? What the hell? Or what are you kids doing with your kids in the bushes? What are you throwing in the bushes that they got to go find? What is it?
Apparently, if I understood correctly, it's the tradition every time they go to the park. It's like, let's go find the wallet, kids. And that's the running joke.
Oh, thank you for translating. That's funny.
I can translate. Come on,
that's funny.
Okay, now I get it.
And so they're like, oh, now we can't do the joke anymore.
It would have been awesome if the husband's like, that's not the only Hershey Highway my wife is supposed to go into.
Okay.
No?
You know, here we are trying to do a feel-good story.
Oh, yeah.
And you know, all right.
What does the wallet look like? Do you have a picture of the wallet?
They said it was gross looking. Right. But how? Why?
The wife's kind of hot, though.
How did they find it 4 years? Let me see the wife.
Right. Oh. Oh, okay.
Yeah.
That's what I was looking at.
Okay.
No wallet.
I don't understand how it takes them 4 years to find this wallet. And by the way,
nobody tried to look for it. They probably just came across it one random day.
And he patted his butt and said, oh, my wallet's not there. And he just kept going like an idiot. Why wouldn't he go back and go, hey, I was on this ride?
Dude, sometimes on one of the rides, they say, look, make sure you have everything secure because if you lose your phone or your wallet, we're not going to stop and look for it. Yeah. They say sometimes you won't, like, they say they might do it like at the end of the day, look for it, but there's no guarantee. Wow. A few of the rides got to the point, like any of like the, I think it was a Universal Studios, if I remember correctly. Any of the rides that had crazy stuff going on where you can lose stuff in your pockets, you had to go through a metal detector because they tell you, put it in the locker. And if you go through the metal detector and you still have your phone in you, they might tell you, hey, go back to the locker and put it in there.
Oh, wow.
They told my wife, because she has like a little purse, that like a little small one that she has, you know, and it's over her shoulder and all that. And that's like a strap. And they wouldn't let us go on the Harry Potter ride until she put that in the locker.
You know why? It's because a lot of times if something falls out and falls in the track, they have to shut the entire ride down to get it out because it could derail the things.
Well, what about your wallet chain? What if it wraps around somebody else on the ride and starts choking them? Come on, man. They got to take that out.
That's a rather extreme thought.
That is.
Well, I mean, you're flying around. That chain could hit somebody in the eye. I mean, you know, why'd they let Danny with his chain on?
It's true. I'm the problem.
And then they say, also, why are you dressing like the 90s, kid? Jesus. They probably should have a detector.
It's fashion, BJ.
They should have a fashion detector and a metal detector. Hey, pal. Tough,
happy birthday, Danny.
Yeah. Hey, thanks.
Pal, get out of here, okay? Come on, get out of here, good Charlotte. We're not letting you on the ride.
So I wear my wallet chain every day so I don't lose my wallet when I'm riding my Harley. See, Danny doesn't have a Harley.
Well, see, now that's the thing. That is
practical.
It's an accessory that started with a bunch of folks that needed it, and then you know what? The 90s punk kids took it over.
But it wasn't fashion for me either at first. It was, but kind of first, I know. Anytime I would go to a show, I lost my wallet three different times in mosh pits, so I started wearing the wallet chain so it wouldn't pop out.
Yeah.
Just saying.
crowd surfers too.
Yeah.
Same reason.
Did you ever get your wallet back from the mosh people?
No.
Okay. Here's a question for you, Steve.
Did you ever use that old funny joke that went, ah, maybe it's in the bushes?
No, I didn't. Oh,
yeah. Yeah. It's a big hit with the kids.
Yeah, lost it.
That's why Danny will never go on the Hershey Highway ever again. Hey, what happened?
That part sucks anyway.
Is that a childhood memory that you're upset because your parents took you there instead of Disney World?
Yes!
That's what I thought. That's what I thought. That's awesome. We're going to go to Hershey Park instead.
Which Mom, is Dad, weird. I want to go to Disney yeah. World. We can't afford it. We're going to Hershey Park instead. You're going to love it.
It's a sad world after all because we're going to Hershey Park.
Probably why I hate chocolate.
Oh, I thought it was another reason, but okay. I got a question, okay?
Yes, sir.
Let's put this train back on the rails here. What happens when someone gets called out on social media for doing one of those copy and paste posts?
Oh, yeah.
It's another edition of Facebook Drama. You're going to hear it at 8:17 on The Rock.
BJ and Migs, mornings on The Rock, 99.9 KISW.
99.9 KISW, The Rock of Seattle.
Now, it's time for Facebook Drama.
And Facebook Drama is brought to you by Beacon Plumbing, Heating, and Mechanical. And BJ, this is our opportunity to point out the morons that are on Facebook. This is an actual Facebook post. The drama unfolds because of it. And of course, we're going to act it out. So this time around, BJ, actually, Rev, you'll be playing the role of the original poster. You will be Frank.
Sweet.
BJ, you'll be Joyce.
Oh, thank you.
All right. I'll play the role of Graham. Vicky, you'll be Nick.
Woo.
And Sarah, you will be Eric.
Oh, hey.
All right. So once again, the original poster is Frank. So Rev, please take it away.
I've failed at times as a husband, father, brother, friend, and son, and as a man. I don't always say the right things. I don't have an amazing physique, but what I do have works for me. I'm not the most handsome man in the world, but I am enough, and I am me. I have scars because I have a history. I don't pretend to be someone I'm not. I am who I am. You can love me or not. And if I love you, I do it with all my heart. I make no apologies for who I am. Men, I dare you to put this on your status and share a picture of yourself if you're proud of who you are. And then I post a picture of myself shirtless on a cliff.
When were you a husband?
Oh, I haven't ever been a husband, but I felt that message needed to be shared.
What's the message? That you're an idiot that couldn't delete husband or father from this stupid copy and paste post? You aren't either.
If my message can inspire others, then it was worth posting.
Who are you trying to inspire? Others to lie about themselves so they can just get likes and attention on Facebook?
Just admit that you posted this so you could share this shirtless picture of yourself. Plus, what scars do you have? You wanna be pretty boy?
Wait, let me get this straight. You aren't a husband, you aren't a dad, and you posted this? Frank, you are a moron. What's next? We find out you aren't even a son either?
Aren't a son? Eric, you might be as dumb as Frank, LOL.
Oh, S, LOL, never mind.
Good point.
Dude, when I saw this one, I was just like,
wow, that's so awesome.
I remember thinking, I don't know, I kind of know this person. I don't think he's a dad or a husband. And
yeah.
I mean, someone called him out.
Yeah, I mean, really. I mean, you can't just edit that up a little bit. I hate those copy and paste things and then forward it to the next guy and bother them now.
I hate them too because I get impressed by my friend's ability to write something really well thought out and eloquent. Like, you see these a lot with random things. Like,
yeah.
Whatever it is. Like, something that affects, like, something negative or positive or whatever, or is heartfelt. You're like, wow. This is an incredible post by this person. As you keep reading, it's like, I didn't know they had this. Oh, they don't have it in them. Because yeah. It ends with copy and paste, don't share.
Yeah.
This is the new chain letters.
Yeah, it's the new chain letters. You're absolutely right.
Stupid.
They are stupid. They really, really are. It's like, I don't need you to inspire me, okay? Thank you. Especially when you are not at all what that copy and paste message is. That is not you at all.
And I mean, I hate to break it to them, but I've never copied and pasted anyone. Is something bad going to happen to me? Am I screwed?
Oh, yeah, dude. You broke the chain.
I did.
Yeah, it's over for you.
Gosh,
I know. I don't know what it is with humans. I don't know why they think that this. It's. I think what's his name was right. He just wanted to post a shirtless picture of himself. And you, I'm all right. I don't got to be anything but me.
And I think the sentiment of this post is that you're supposed to post a picture that's not necessarily flattering. to kind of just show, hey, man, we're all just human. We're all
just
doing this.
Me.
And this guy decided to pick, like, his most epic picture.
Yeah.
Shirtless on a cliff.
Yeah, that's not the deal. Yeah. How about you just on the couch, like, half asleep?
Look at me and all my flaws. I have muscles and I'm shirtless on a cliff.
Yeah. Yeah.
So he says the Rev's playing too much Red Dead Redemption with that hillbilly accent.
Sure is.
Darn tootin'. Rev, are you still doing that game?
I am still playing the game, and talking about the accent, I actually did that on accident and was started talking in a Western accent just in a normal conversation with someone. I was like, oh, I gotta back off on this game a little bit.
Now, that's not telling me that you're not digging Fallout 76, because you were playing that a lot, too.
Oh, yeah.
He's doing both.
Yeah, I didn't, like, you guys did stuff on the vacation, well, quote-unquote vacation, because you went to Philly to do stuff. Steve did his East Coast tour and did all this stuff. I stayed at home almost the entire time playing either Fallout or Red Dead.
Look at you. You were Cartman.
Oh, it was perfect, man.
Oh, man.
One of my buddies actually, Vicky's buddy too, Christian Andy, he's a wrestler in town, and he posted something on his Facebook saying, Red Dead Redemption players, what's the most epic, crazy thing that you've seen happen while you were playing? And somebody says, I guess her boyfriend or husband, Chuck, plays it. He's going through a farm and found a dude in one of the stalls that clearly died while having sex with a sheep.
No.
I haven't found that one yet.
And then says it was super funny. The sheep had a pink bow on it.
Wow.
Oh, need to be purdy.
The fish bit a dude's butt, wouldn't let go. He got on his horse, rode for 5+ minutes with the fish stuck on his butt.
Wow, they've done a really good job with this game.
Another person said they killed a guy, then his horse, walked over, and then took a crap on the dead dude.
Yeah. You can do that in that game?
Rev?
Wow. Well, it's not like necessarily you telling the horse to go poop on the, you know, dude. It's just the horse.
Do you hit the X button or the Y button to make that happen?
Yeah, I need to know.
Press the Duke button. There's a little poo emoji on the controller.
Nice. Damn, dude.
What's the craziest thing you've seen in this game?
I haven't gotten too crazy with it. Just I'm running around trying just to play the game, so it's nothing too insane about it. I do like shooting people in the face, though. Most of the time I do it on accident. I'm trying to talk to a person, and suddenly it's like it starts getting into like a little heated thing, and you're like trying to press. There's a button that literally says diffuse, like you're like trying to back off or something, and I always press the wrong button and shoot the guy in the face.
Wait, so what goes on when you talk to the person when you're playing a game? Do you what kind of conversation you have with the person?
Yeah, and so like when you're riding by them on horse, you can greet them, you can antagonize, you can go to rob them.
I'd rob every time.
Oh, of course you would.
Well, that's the problem is you're like, I'm gonna rob you, so I'm gonna pull out my gun. And then they're like, well, you're not going to rob me. So then you have to shoot them. And then you get chased by the lawmen. It's a whole rigmarole.
Yeah.
It's a big kind of pain in the ass, to be
Take
perfectly
it easy,
honest.
Don't be in Red Dead Redemption. They'll find you.
So I should just antagonize them.
Yeah, pretty much.
Is this game available for Xbox One?
No. Yeah. Yes, okay. It is.
Mm-hmm. I'm going to have to put this on my Christmas list.
Oh, yeah. Really?
This sounds awesome. One person just texted Janice, says I got hit by a ram completely out of nowhere.
I'm going to get, I would be happy to make sure you get this game, or maybe somebody will get it for you. But I'm only so we can take the over under how long you will play this game.
An hour, because he won't get past the 2-hour prologue.
Yeah.
Oh, it's longer than that, man.
Longer than that. Okay.
Yeah.
He's not, don't ask for this.
Santa. Like snow.
Santa, just get me WWE.
Yeah.
I'm going to say 10 minutes.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, somebody asked, we talked, I guess, I forgot that we talked about me buying the Beastie Boys book, and I was supposed to read it on my trip to
New York for Thanksgiving.
How'd
that work? And
I didn't bring it with me. I don't even know where the book is anymore.
Uncle Chris had a really good gift idea for you when it came to the WWE. He said, I think I can get score something from old school WWF days.
Oh, yeah?
But I said, no, he's not going to use it.
Is it a championship belt?
It's a video game. He thought he could track down one of the original video games.
Oh.
But I said, Steve.
Like a tabletop one?
Steve only likes to play it when he can make himself a character. And then he stops playing it right after he makes his own character. He doesn't actually wrestle with it.
Yeah, we'll see what happens. Yeah. I mean, I put it on my Christmas. Well, I ordered it, so I know I'm getting it.
I think Santa's going to bring it to me since I ordered it.
Well, I had it delivered under my wife's name. So.
Oh, good call. So you won't know it's coming.
How bad is that? I didn't even bother to be like, can I have this? I just saw it was a Black Friday deal. It was like half off.
Oh, that's a great deal.
Yeah. So I was like, I don't know how long this window is. So I just ordered it and put on the bill, on the shipping address, my wife's name. And I said, babe, I already, just so you know, I got a Christmas gift that you're going to have to wrap for me.
That's awesome. See, now my son loves that kind of shopping because there was a game that I wanted, but there was no way he'd be able to get it in the stores. You had to go through this rigmarole to get it. Uh-huh. So I had my buddy get it for me.
I like how we're using the word rigmarole, even when Texter says I'm impressed by the use of the word rigmarole.
Yeah.
And now we've used it four times.
Yeah. Well, you know,
good job.
It's a good word. We got to bring it back.
Yes.
But you know, it's my buddy goes, won't your family want to go get the present myself? No. If you tell my son that you got a present he can give me, my son will be like, sweet. And that's exactly what they did. So I know what I'm getting, even though I shouldn't know what I'm getting.
That's awesome.
Yeah. I mean, that makes Christmas so much better if you don't have to run around like a crazy person. I still will go do some shopping because I think it's fun. But if I can go to a mall and go do some shopping and get something I think they'd like, mm-hmm. knowing I've already got them what they want, that's a fun time. You know, as opposed to, oh, my wife always asks for these weird things, and I can never find them because it's always a woman's clothing store item. Get me a cute blue sweater, but not one that I won't like. And I'm like, what the hell does that mean? How am I going to find that out? But don't go to an expensive store. Oh, but don't give me anything cheap.
Okay, that's too vague.
I know, but that's my wife. My wife does it all the time. And so I was like, you know what, honey? You need to go online and order whatever you want, and then just I'll wrap it. Because I'm done with walking around in the store going, will this fit her? Will that not fit her? Because 50% of the stuff we get or gets returned.
Mm. Okay, that is pretty frustrating, but at least your family doesn't say, oh no, save your money, don't buy me anything, we're not doing Christmas presents this year. My mom always does that. She, no, there's no money this year for presents, so I'm not buying anyone any gifts, and then there are the gifts. And so we have to make sure we also get gifts, otherwise we're going to feel like, you know, jackasses.
Yeah,
and
I
they
know.
Don't tell us what they want. I'm like, mom, yeah, do you need new shoes?
I just take
socks?
I take it for face value. I'm like, alright, no gifts for you.
Cool. Yeah, but you know what?
But I want gifts.
You'll get that look, though. You'll get the mom look like,
no, I
know. Really not get me a gift.
So it's like I have to actually figure out, and we never get it right.
My favorite
is she never uses it.
We share the same PayPal for our, like, you know, so I will, but it's attached to my email, so I kind of get ideas of what I'm getting because
get
the PayPal, so I'm like, I know something's coming from Fred Meyer, but I'm not sure what, or something's coming from Best Buy.
Oh, that's awesome.
It's kind of exciting. Like, what is it going
to
be?
Oh, that puts a little mystery into the holiday.
So you go back to the Red Dead Redemption thing, says if you want to get Steve a good gift, get him Red Dead 2, play it through the prologue. If it's pre-installed on his Xbox, he could just jump in and play. He'd be so happy.
Right. Oh, that's the gift itself.
I have to get him the gift and play it, and then give it to you.
Just get me to the point where I can start killing horses and pooping on people.
Well, you could just come over to my house and you could do the whole thing in my steampunk bar.
It's a good point. And really, you don't need a video game for that, Steve.
Yeah, you could wear your Halloween costume and it'll be perfect.
In. Yeah. We'll just take an Enum Claw. You can do all that.
So he says, I hogtied someone in Red Dead and put them in the train tracks and took a selfie as they were hit by the train.
See, I did hogtie the person and I did put them on the train tracks, but then I felt bad. Like, I would be the worst outlaw in the Old West because I would feel bad and then I was like, oh, I'll take you off of that. I'm sorry.
And if you wonder why this is such a disturbing game, it's made by the same people that made Grand Theft Auto. So
yeah, it's GTA in the Wild West. It really absolutely is.
One text says Red Dead's the best game ever. Another person, 45-year-old man who was introduced to Red Dead Redemption by his 16-year-old son. I'm absolutely addicted. I spent almost the entire weekend doing nothing but irritating my wife by playing it. It's fantastic. From Chris in Tacoma.
Yeah. I don't know. You know what, Sarah? That might be a good gift for Johnny Rubbers. There you go. I'll think about that.
Or J-Rubs, as they like to call him.
Oh, is it J-Rubs? That's his new name now? J-Rubs?
Yep. He has a nickname for the nickname.
Okay.
J Rubs with a Z, right?
Yeah. J Rubs with a Z.
Isn't that awesome?
Was he a Trailer Park Boys character now?
Or a bad 90s rapper.
Oh, that's awesome.
What's up, J Rubs?
J Rubs, hey. You know what I'm saying?
With a Z.
Yeah. Yesterday, Steve, he barely got this one right.
What is the first month of the year comprised of exactly 30 days?
January.
No.
February. No.
That wasn't a guess.
Okay.
Guess what?
March.
No.
April.
Yeah.
You got so lucky, dude.
And just so people...
You got so lucky when we let you take February back.
But, you know, I still won by like 4. So it wasn't as if it would have made a difference.
Yeah, you know what, though? Yeah, you know what, though? I'm watching you. I got my eye on you, buddy.
It was like I was about to throw the ball, but I caught it before I threw it.
I see it. You know what? It was definitely on the cutting edge. It was like a check swing.
Yep.
We had to go to the first base umpire to see, in fact, if you crossed the line or not.
And Danny said it was fine.
I don't trust Danny.
Yeah.
Yeah, even though we're using his cell phone number so you can play this game. Yeah. Our phone is still broken, so you want to beat Steve, you got to call Danny's cell phone, 206.
It never gets fixed, and this is the number we use forever.
Oh, yeah, you know it's going to be. I already know that's happening. 206-449-1181. We're playing Beat Migs at 847 on The Rock.
Today's podcast was brought to you by Travis Gagne, bankruptcy attorney. Here's another question from a listener. How long is a bankruptcy going to affect my credit rating?
Of course, most of the time, by the time we're talking about filing a bankruptcy, the credit has already taken a huge hit. Chapter 7 is going to affect it more negatively than Chapter 13. Chapter 7 stays on your credit report for 10 years from the time you file. It usually takes 7 or 8 years for your credit scores to get back into the normal range in a Chapter 7 case. However, your credit will start to recover even in Chapter 7 after about a year. You'll be able to get credit again right away, usually before your case is even over. Chapter 13 stays on your credit report for 7 years and usually takes about 3 or 3.5 years for your credit to get back in the normal range. So Chapter 13 will mean your credit gets better much more rapidly.
Thanks, Travis. If you have more questions about bankruptcy, you can reach out to Travis anytime at ChooseTheRightChapter.com. That's ChooseTheRightChapter.com. Thanks for listening.